Hey GBA fans, I'm Choice CJ, and I am here today with my good buddy Zilix. Say hello.
Sorry GBA fans, Zilix here.
And we are bringing you guys today the weekly recap for week one of the GBA D-League season number 3. We hope you guys are looking forward to this video. We're quite excited to record it. Quick point of order before we start. Zilix and I are actually recording this before any of the videos are going up. Just due to the Labor Day holiday, it's hard to find enough time to record this after the battles have gone up. So you guys will know a lot more about these games than we do. And unfortunately, you know, even though we do have the replays, we don't have crystal balls to know exactly what each coach was thinking on each turn of each game. So thanks in advance for bearing with us. And without further ado, let's hop on into this first game, which took place between Coach Randy, HLD Productions, coach of the Texas Rangers, and It's Gregulator 60, coach of the Los Angeles Clefable. Randy brought Typhoo Koko, Mega Scizor, Hydreigon, Hawlucha, Nidoking, and Jellicent. Meanwhile, Greg brought Celesteela, Gallade, Gallipod, Nihilego, Rotom Cut, and Zygarde 50%. The game starts off pretty quickly just in terms of getting up hazards on both sides. There's a Focus Sash lead Nidoking going up and getting up rocks versus Rotom Cut, and then a Assault Vest Hydreigon switches in on the Rotom, gives Greg a quick opportunity to set up rocks with a Nihilego. I liked the EQ play that came out from Randy. He was able to snipe that Nihilego on turn 4. And Nihilego was a really big win con for Greg because it was able to take on some of Randy's special attackers pretty well. Gallade comes in and is able to revenge kill Randy Sacks the Nidoking. And Typhoo Koko comes in and starts to really do work. Typhoo Koko is really applying a lot of pressure to Greg's team. He's able to set up a substitute on a Rotom Cut and get off a clean 75% with Dazzling Gleam on Zygarde 50. It was had the potential to go for a Twinkle Tackle, but Randy conserved the Twinkle Tackle for later. We have the Mega Scizor switch in. The Scizor is going to be hard countered by Greg's Gallipod. And the Gallipod actually kind of puts Randy in a precarious situation because it sets up two layers of spikes a few turns later. And the reason that this is big is because a lot of Randy's team is grounded, and if Gallade is packing the right moveset, it can pick off a weakened Typhoo Koko with Shadow Sneak. As we see, as the game progresses, Hawlucha comes in and gets an Electric Seed boost from the Electric Terrain from Typhoo Koko, is able to revenge kill a Zygarde 50%, is able to get off critical damage on the Celesteela. Celesteela ends up killing a Hawlucha, brings the Koko back in. Koko kills the Celesteela, and Gallade, if it had the Shadow Snake, could have brought it close, but we're going to see that Koko is going to be able to kill the Gallade with Dazzling Gleam, and it's going to end up being a 3-0 victory for Randy and the Texas Rangers. So, really interesting game. Typhoo Koko applying a lot of pressure, hazards being important on both sides, but Greg just not having a good response for the Koko, either offensively or defensively, sort of spelled doom for him. Zilix, do you have any thoughts on this game?
I think it was a bit of an interesting one because I don't think a lot of people were expecting the win in that favor. So, you know, these D-League coaches, they're going to be surprising us each week, and this is definitely an instance of that. So next up, we had Magic and the Memphis Drizzlies versus Dan in the Roserade-N-Borg, that is a tough one to say. Dan brought the Frostlass, Stunfisk, Darmanitan, Espeon, Magearna, and Mega Absol, and on Magic side of the field, he had the Manchow, Lander's Tea, Mega Venusaur, Jolteon, Melodic, and Kartana. So early on, started it the same way as the last one. There was a Frostlass with Focus Sash, trying to set up some hazards, gets up a layer of spikes. Magic gets some huge damage off on that with a knockoff, bringing it down to 1 HP. And Dan is just kind of pivoting around here, taking a bit of damage from Magic. This damage does allow Magic to eventually get a knockout because his Mega Venusaur goes for a Sludge Bomb versus the Espeon, gets a lucky poison, and is able to take it down. This, however, does allow for Dan to get a revenge kill on the Mega Venusaur with his own Mega Absol. Again, lots of switching going on, not really much happening on either side. I guess this is mainly just Dan learning what type of sets that Magic has, because the Kartana reveals that it is not Scarfed as it switches moves. and some other things of the likes of that. But eventually, Dan gets his Mega Absol back in the field and sets up a Calm Mind versus the Milotic. Now, normally in a situation like this, you would see the Milotic go for a Dragon Tail or a Haze to get rid of the stat boost, but the Milotic opts to go for the Mirror Coat. So this is the perfect opportunity for Dan to start setting up Calm Minds. I believe he gets to plus 3, and he goes for a Baton Pass into Magearna, who then gets off a Shift Gear, and that is pretty much the game right there, because the Magearna goes for the Z Shattered Psyche versus the Milotic, and proceeds to sweep the rest of Magic's team for a 5-0 victory in Dan's favor. Fast match.
Yeah, that really says it all. And I mean, a lot of people who are watching this season are probably gonna have lots of strong feelings about Magearna, and I'm certainly amongst those people who thinks Magearna is very overwhelming to prepare for in draft league. That being said, I think if it had been any like other Pokemon at that point that had the ability to boost speed and it received a +3/+3 boost, I think it would have been good game no matter what. So, you know, imagine packing that into like a Flame Charge Victini or something like that, just to give a random example. That probably would have spelled doom either way.
Yeah, I think it was less of a showcase of how good Magearna is and more of a showcase as like why you should probably bring Haze on your Milotic if there's a potential Swords Dancing Mega Absol and a Magearna, you know. So there's a lot of reasons to bring, you know, ways to clear up setup, and probably should have done it this week.
Yeah, probably. And hats off to Danicky for a really creative team this week. So next up, we are going to hop into the match between the Montreal Habsols and the New York Klynx. Aster, coach of the Habsols, did bring his Thundurus, Infernape, Quillfish, Metagross, Umbreon, and Blastoise. Meanwhile, Papa C brought Manaphy, Sandslash, Skarmory, Hoopa, Sylveon, and Tauros. The action got off to a really quick start. Scarf Hoopa was able to come in, hit a Quillfish with a Zen Headbutt. It was a minus one, so it actually didn't take out the Quillfish, but the Quillfish was Focus Sash in any case. So what that allowed Aster to do was to retaliate with a Fel Stinger, which would have been a roll to kill, but he did land a crit to guarantee that it took out Papa C's arguably biggest threat. Aster brought a very bulky team, and it would have taken a lot of damage from a potential wall-breaking Hoopa, but that's not going to be the case in this game. Papa C does bring his Tauros in, and he's able to get his quick kill of his own, as the Tauros is able to 2-hit KO the incoming Umbreon with Rock Climb, revealing itself to be Life Orb. Then what we have next is some careful maneuvering on both sides. There's some bulky Mons. There's a Spidef Sylveon that's taking hits very easily from Blastoise. There's a Fizdef Skarmory that's playing around Metagross. The Skarmory also has Whirlwind. There's a turn where, unfortunately, the Skarmory brings in the Thundurus, and it's going to get scared out. The Sandslash does come in on that Thundurus, and it gets an opportunity to spin. But then a few turns later, Metagross does set up rocks again, and the next time that Sandslash is in, it's actually in versus the Blastoise, and Blastoise is going to be able to kill with a Scald, preventing any further hazard removal. Sylveon is switching in on that Blastoise, able to get up a Wish, heal up a couple members of the team. Metagross is in versus this Sylveon, and Papa C actually switches in his Manaphy on said Metagross and takes a clean 60% from Thunder Punch. So it appears to be a very offensive Manaphy, not a lot of defensive investment there. It's going to go for a Surf and take a little bit of damage off of that Metagross, but then Metagross is able to kill it with Thunder Punch. And then at that point, it was sort of squaring up to be this way, but Thundurus is able to get a kill on the Skarmory. This is going to leave Papa C with just his Sylveon and his Tauros. Sylveon is able to play around a little bit, heal up the Tauros on a Thundurus that's going for Volt Switch, but the Volt Switch does bring in the Infernape, and Tauros is not at a range of HP where it can survive a close combat, and then the Sylveon is easily in range of a CC from Scarf Infernape. So that is going to finish up the game 4-0 for the Habsols. And yeah, once the hazard game was settled, it was really just a sort of a slow decay for Papa C. He he was having an issue breaking through Aster's team, and once his team was whittled, Thundurus and Scarf and Furnape were just there to pick up the pieces. What do you think about this game?
Having two mons like that are very capable of late game sweeping on both the special side and the physical side with Infernape Thundurus can be very terrifying, because it's hard to preserve your walls late game, especially whenever you have to cover both sides like that. So next up was Jack versus Abe. Jack decided to bring the Volcarona, Megalopony, Registeel, Latios, Staraptor, and Clefable, while Abe had the Mega Beedrill, Alolan Persian, Primarina, Mamoswine, Kamo-O, and Emboar. At the start of the battle, Jack got off some pretty nice damage versus Mamoswine with his own Clefable, while still remaining at a very healthy amount of HP, at the cost of having rocks set up on his side of the field. This is important because he does have things like the Volcarona and the Staraptor that do not want to switch into rocks, and if they do, it's going to limit their switch-ins by quite a lot because of their weakness. The rocks do end up getting removed, though, as there is a bit of switching with the Latios coming in going for the defog, and the first KO happens as Mamoswine goes down. Abe then brings in his Kamo-O and sets up a Dragon Dance, getting huge damage off against the Clefable, just missing out on the KO, but unfortunately, because it did not pick up that KO, Clefable is able to go for the Fairy-type move, sending Kamo-O to the next dimension, putting Abe down 6-4. However, he very quickly recovers, getting a revenge kill with the Mega Beedrill, and it allows Jack to attempt to set up with Volcarona, but it does come in on rocks, dropping it down to the 50% HP, and the Alolan Persian comes in and goes for a parting shot to try to slow down the setup. Added with the damage from the rocks and the incoming Emboar, it forces the Volcarona to switch out, and Jack chooses to sacrifice his Latios against the Emboar, which is now at +2 speed because it's going for flame charges to get these knockouts. With Latios down, it's very likely that rocks are going to stay up on the side of the field for Jack, and then Jack then opts to go into his Registeel to try to deal with the Emboar, which does result in a double down as Emboar knocks itself out with the Flare Blitz, and the Registeel is able to get enough damage to guarantee that knockout. Then the Volcarona just switches into rocks, dying on entry, leaving Jack with only his Staraptor and Lopunny to deal with the rest of Abe's team. The Staraptor is able to output big damage before going down, allowing the Lopunny to revenge kill, which then it attempts to set up power-up punches to try to stay in the battle, but it does go down to the Alolan Persian, resulting in a 2-0 victory for Abe.
This could have been a really interesting game at the end there with that Lopunny if it had had some sort of priority, or if it had a better fighting stab to take on the Persian. Maybe it did have fighting stab, but he elected to set up a second power-up punch on that Persian. Again, we're not watching these from YouTube. We're watching these ahead of time, so we don't know all the sets. But it could have made the end game very different if there were just subtle changes on the moveset. But I think setting up the +2 probably made sense with the moveset that he had, and unfortunately didn't work out for him that time.
He may have had Quick Attack to deal with the Mega Beedrill and potentially needed to get to +2 to be able to knock it out.
Yeah, I think that's probably correct, but I'm sure we will we'll be told if that's not the case by our by our friends in the comments. And thank you everybody for helping, of course. Let's hop into our final matchup, which took place between the Durham Dreadagons, coached by 6 Foot Hacks, aka Leo, and the Toronto Staraptors, coached by Jolt of the Token Minorities. Leo brought Kieran Black, Donphan, Greninja, Savali Steel, Mega Aerodactyl, and Reuniclus. Meanwhile, Jolt brought Zoroark, Scolipede, Tornadus T, Seismitoad, Mew, and Mega Kangaskhan. Lead matchup is Kieran Black versus an apparent Mega Kangaskhan, but when the Mega Kangaskhan does not Mega Evolve and lands a Focus Blast on the incoming Rocky Helmet Donphan, it becomes obvious that this is actually a Zoroark in disguise, and landing that damage on the Donphan is going to be very critical for the longevity of that Kangaskhan later in the match. Leo's able to pivot into his Reuniclus, take the next Focus Blast. A little switching occurs, and the real Mega Kangaskhan is in versus the Kieran Black a few turns later. Kangaskhan's going to go for the workup, and the Kieran Black's going to reveal Focus Blast of its own and is going to be able to take out that Kangaskhan before it's able to do any damage. But unlucky for Leo, the trouble doesn't stop there, as a setup Mew is going to switch in on this Kyurem Black and going to go for a bulk up. The bulk up does about 55% to Mega Arrow, which was his initial switch in. And then afterwards, Savali comes in, threatens the Mew out with a Toxic, but the Scolipede is going to be able to come in, absorb that Toxic no problem, and go for an SD on the switch into Donphan. Donphan will die to an Aqua Tail. Savali Steel is going to die to a +2 Savage Spinout. And then it's looking like this could be a clean sweep for the Scolipede, but unfortunately for Jolt, the Mega Horn is going to miss on the Kyurem Black, and the Kyurem Black will land an Ice Beam that puts it in range of a Water Shuriken from Greninja. After the Scolipede does go down, Torn is going to come in, get off about 50% damage with a U-turn, and then Seismitoad, quote-unquote, comes in and is actually going to go for a Scarf U-turn because it is, again, the Zoroark. It's going to be able to net that kill. Mew comes in, and with only Reuniclus and Aerodactyl left on Leo's side, the bulk up Mew is going to be able to easily pick up the last two kills, and we have on our hands a very interesting 4-0 victory for Jolt. So it was just sort of setup mayhem for the Toronto Staraptors. The workup Kang, the bulk up Mew, the SD Scolipede, and it really put the work in versus Leo's team, I gotta say. Zilix, what are your thoughts?
People are gonna have to look out for those setups. It's just the way it is, you know. If teams have multiple ways of setting up, it's gonna happen. So people gotta be prepared for that.
Absolutely. And that is our final game. And with that, we are going to take a quick look at the week one standings. Why don't you take it away, Zilix?
So right now, I believe the way it is working is we have the top four teams and then the rest of the teams are considered out. So right now at number one, we have the Rosa Radenborg with the best differential right now with +5. Then we have the Montreal Habsols with 4, the Toronto Star Raptors also with 4, and the Texas Rangers with 3. So out of those four teams, it basically all the teams that won this week minus one, so the Newcastle Umbreon are at 2, so they're just shy of being in that top 4 position. Obviously, as the season goes on, this list will shape a bit more, but this is where it's at right now. I wouldn't say all the matches were expected, as some of them were a bit shocking, but maybe a few here and there were, so it'll be interesting to see, you know, which teams stay at the top and which teams, you know, kind of fall towards the middle or the bottom.
Yeah, I agree. There's a lot of coaches in this league that are very talented, and we'll be looking to see some of them bounce back after disappointing week one losses. This is going to be a competitive season for the next 10 weeks or next 9 weeks. And looking forward to seeing how everybody does.
And then next up, we have our league leaders from week one. Obviously, at the very top, we have Magearna getting those 5 kills in the battle. Very impressive and a very good way to start off the season. Next up, we have that Tapu Koko getting that electric seed, you know, boost, and then getting 3 kills without any deaths. And then we have the Scolipede getting 3 kills with 1 death. For the rest of the list, we have the Infernape, the Mew, the Emboar, Mega Gallade, Mega Absol, and Mega Beedrill. Surprisingly, there aren't any like weird mons in the League Leaders Week 1. That's usually a trend in the GBA, with things like Claydol being like top 3. In Umbreon. Nothing crazy this week, so it definitely shows that, you know, this is going to be a competitive season. People are utilizing their offensive mons to their full capabilities and getting the kills with them.
Are you meaning to say that Claydol is not a competitive Pokemon?
I might be implying that. Maybe just a little bit.
Okay, alright, well, I'll take your word for it, I guess. Hope you guys did enjoy that recap that, of course, does wrap things up for us. Make sure you check out next week for the week 2 weekly recap. And we are doing a bunch of other series on the GBA channel for the D-League season number 3. We do have some power rankings coming out. Hope you guys are looking forward to that. We, of course, have fantasy. Hope you guys can participate in the GBA fantasy. And make sure, of course, that you check out all of our fantastic coaches, all of our new D-League coaches. Zilix, do you have anything else to say before we sign off?
Not much. I'll see you guys next time.
Yeah, thank you guys for watching, and we will see you guys later. Peace.